And welcome back to Let's Roll a Die. Welcome back to Let's Play Steve Jackson's, interactively play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. Once again, this is a Let's Play where you get to, at the end of the video, choose one of the choices presented to continue the story into the following video. Of course, majority rules, except in, well, cases in which we have a tie, which we do this time. I only got two votes last time. Some people missing. Miss you guys. I don't know. I think it was a long episode. I think I've had several long episodes. It's just the way the story's been unfolding. Like, there really haven't been any major narrative decisions, and that's why I decided. That's why I really like to put these things on a decision that seems, you know, of some import. Anyway, so we got a tie. I don't even remember offhand what the question is, but one person vote to cast a spell, which is a certain spell. I'll have to go. Oh, it's the mirror image, right? Like the mirror image type spell. Okay, so another person vote to strike the glass where the mirror image is presented. So a roll of 1 and 2 will be to cast the mirror image spell, or whatever they call it in this game. I know it is mirror image, and 3 or 4 will be to strike the glass. So let's roll a d4 and see what we get. We're going to cast a mirror image spell. And back in the game. Running through all these little towers. Meet this stranger that looks a lot like me. My eyes seem to slide off her features. But we asked her a bunch of questions. And as we're talking, the two of us have edged closer together. You now stand on either side of the glass in the middle of the room is a mirror. The stranger approaches and pauses on the other side of the mirror. So we're casting the spell. Kind of curious. What kind of result this will have? I don't even remember what the thing is. That's force field. Hope you'll find it relatively quickly. Goblin, no. Clumsiness. That's fireball. Create wind. Stupidity. Replica creature. Sorry, guys. Light, right? Yeah. Clone the caster. We're gonna clone the caster, is what it is. You craft the spell, but no clones materialize. Instead, a large crack appears in the pane of glass. A moment later, it shatters and collapses. A counterspell, then? So, the spell of self-duplication opposes the enchantment of mirroring. The 6 kin counterspell has been recorded in your spellbook. The glass lies in shards all around the frame. Some of them catch the light oddly. The stranger, your reflection, steps back, clutching at her chest. All right. So we already had 6. We already had kin. So that's a counter spell for kin. Okay. Are you unwell? I am fine, she shouts back, but she is clearly staggering. Wait. You pause, seeing how the reflection will act. She paces near the frame, seemingly unable to approach. Step forward. You step through the empty frame, glance crunching under your boots. The reflection draws her sword, unaffected by her movements. It seems she is now free to act. Leave me, she says, or I will send you back. Back where? There, she snarls, pointing at the mirror. I will not fall for your tricks. You may look like me, but I know you are only an apparition. I am the Annalander. The other laughs. No, she replies simply. You cannot claim that. Let us work together. Oh no, the other nods her head. You will not trick me. And with that, she turns and races from the room. A moment later, all goes black and you find yourself outside. You sheathe your blade outside the tower, glad to be away from the mirror demon. Okay then. So we can go this way. I'm not sure if we've been to this tower yet. I'm not sure. You ascend onto a walkway flying high between two towers and set against the outer wall of the citadel. The view down is dizzying. Smoke from a burnt-out tower below makes you choke. You look around at the sprawling towers that fill this region of the citadel. They all appear ancient, featureless, but they are in excellent repair. Some power is holding their dark stones together. You make your way carefully across the bridge. You hurry over another walkway, higher in the air than you had expected, towards the next tower. The sun is sinking. Soon it will be dark once more. From the doorway comes a steady clock-like ticking sound. Go inside. You step inside and the ticking grows louder. I can hear it. It's very slow ticking. Something heavy whooshes slowly past over your head. The looming presence is oddly comforting, and you feel your eyelids starting to close. It's got like a pendulum. Your eyes are getting sleepy. So sleepy. Soon you will go to sleep. Look up. You tilt your head to look up, and your eyelids begin to roll themselves closed. For a moment before they shut, you catch sight of an enormous brass weight swinging past overhead. The pendulum overhead ticks another tock. A great weight settles around your body. Look around. The chamber is an empty space of old flagstones. A few weeds have broken through here and there, and it looks like there was once some kind of soft furnishing on the floor, but it has long since rotted away. You count three exits spaced evenly around the edge of the bell-shaped tower, but you cannot keep your eyes open. You fall down where you stand, or lie down where you stand, sorry, in the middle of the floor, and are quickly asleep. Oh, great. Three exits. I guess we're dreaming. Through it all, you feel the heat of Annalan burning should your quest fail. Another night begins. Eventually, you open your eyes once more. Several hours have passed. Cast a spell. What would counter sleepiness? I'm thinking it might be a good idea to, like, learn as much counters as we can. This might help us in our final battle against, the Archmage. Talk with animals. Oops. Hey, I clicked on O, didn't I? Summon a giant. We looked at that one. D. Cause fear. Illusion of worship. Maybe fear would be the opposite of sleep? Because you're definitely wide awake when you're have fear. Unknown. That's lightning. I think Zob will try. I did try this one once before, and I don't think it did anything. The spell you are casting fails. Something which you have got, is needed for this spell. You find yourself yawning once more. Okay, let's leave. You drag yourself across the floor. Your body feels heavy, and your mind is filled with fog. A dead weight is settling over your bones. Leave. You crawl towards the door. How many hours have passed inside this tower now? Tiredness overtakes you again. You drop to the floor with little warning. Mocking laughter seems to ring in your ears. Tower of Sleep. During the past day, you gained some maximum stamina, +6. That was awesome. Ran out of provisions and found no new clues. The Archmage is still waiting for you. You wake up once more, and once more struggle to your feet. You fight the lethargy that fills your body and crawl for the tower's exit. Okay, I was thinking we might not be able to leave. Looks like this is the, we'll visit this tower in this corner, and then make our way back around. The path winds between crumbling towers and dagger-like buttresses. The early morning sun makes the air glow. The path runs up to the far wall of the citadel, passing dangerously close to a large circular pit in the ground. Trip in the hole. Look at the pit. The pit is large and perfectly circular, descending into the bare rock below for some distance. Curiously, the water all around does not seem to flow into the hole. Okay, so, yeah, that's not a tower. I thought it looked different. Throw a gold coin. Cast a spell. Let's see if I can feather fall or float down or something. Let's read minds. I don't think there's any mind around to be read. T-O... Unknown. Huh. I'll try it. Top. Reaching up to the stars, you create the magic, and the blonde wig in your hands begins to shiver. A single hair detaches itself, starting to shine and glow, before extending and burying itself into the ground. The top spell has been added to your spellbook. A moment later, the ground beneath your feet has begun soaring upwards, taking you with it. What? Oh, I can't. Alright. Where the hell did I go? Oh. I don't want to do this yet. I didn't want to go up there yet. The growth of the tower stops and slows, leaving you a short distance away from the upper turret of the Archmage's tower, facing a window. Between it and you is a near-infinite drop. The spell will not last long. I don't want to go up there yet. I got more stuff to explore. I mean, if the game ends here, I'm assuming? Let's see if I can get back down. Zen, maybe? You wind the constellations into alignment around you, and the medallion begins to glow as you rise gently up into the air. You feel the tower shifting under your feet. Alright. I was hoping I would float down. I obviously don't know what I'm doing. I don't want to go there yet. Safe passage. Probably towards the window, but I don't want to go there yet. Cause sleepiness? And we can't rewind. Rewind is disabled. In this section of the... Well, G doesn't go anywhere. Zen... Zip? Teleportation. Lightning? Well, teleportation, hope we don't die horribly. You cast the enchantment, trusting to luck, as the ring of green metal on your finger begins to gleam like a serpent's eye. You close your eyes as your body is wrenched away. You reappear a short distance away. So yeah, my reason out of game, meta, is that I don't want the game to end just yet. I have more exploring to do. My reason inside the game is, well, we need to explore these towers and find out more of these counter spells, don't we? Okay. Jeez. Alright. You're standing inside a turret just beside a large stained glass window. This is the top of the highest tower in Zeeman. This is the garret of the Archmage himself. You are mere footsteps from your goal. Your weight returns and you settle gradually back down to the ground. Look out the window. Looking out of the window, you see a dizzying drop to the citadel below. Let me try Zen now. I really don't want to do this right now, guys. I don't have it. F is like Featherfall or something? See the future? No. Was there another letter? No. This is... yeah. Sense danger. Protect from magic. Yeah, I don't see anything that's gonna get me back down there. Resurrect. Damn it, alright. You know, let me cast a See the Future spell. Those are always pretty interesting. Doesn't cost anything, so... You sit cross-legged on the ground and put your palms on the orb of crystal. Looking to the constellations above, you craft a spell, and everything changes. You see yourself in a small turret room with a man wearing a crown of jewels and bone. You are sipping wine together and talking like old friends. The visions fade. From somewhere below, there comes the echo of screams. Hmm. A crown of jewel and bones? Is that the crown of kings? Like old friends? Ready myself? You take a deep breath and ready yourself. Then you reach out and try the handle of the door. It turns. The door is not enchanted, nor cursed. It is not even locked. After so many miles, so much hardship and pain, the final door is well awaited and requires nothing more than the gentlest of pushes to swing open. I really want to rewind somehow. But we can't. We cannot do so. I have whole sections of the city I haven't seen yet. I can't go down. I can only go to the garret. Is this... does the Archmage lie up here? You climb the stairs to the garret. It is a tiny stone room, the walls plastered with astrological charts, some ancient and some so fresh that their ink still gleams. In the center of the space is a desk. And sitting behind it... behind the desk is a wizened old man with long shocks of black hair. He holds a quill pen and looks up curiously as you enter. Yes? Can I help you? Is this the Archmage? He looks kind of brutish, doesn't he? I have come for the crown. The man frowns with evident puzzlement, but he seems to understand. You must be the Annalander. The Annal Land herself. My serpent told me you were coming. I do hope you didn't think that the skies would fool me. Please take it off. Welcome. The man before you is a pale shadow of the Archmage you encountered in your dream outside the city walls, and he has no crown. Greetings. I'm not going to take off the disguise. I do not follow your commands. You answer with a heavy nod. The man looks back at you sadly, silent for a moment. Doubt begins to creep into your heart. Can this truly be the cruel Archmage of High Zaman? He seems tired, even shy. I see you have traveled a long way, he remarks. You must be tired. Please, sit. We may talk as equals for a moment. He gestures to a chair. Hmm. Wait, is this the end of the game? That would suck. Sorry, guys. sure, I'll sit. I can't believe, though, I cast this random spell. I had no idea this would be what would happen. Cautiously, you move toward the seat indicated. It seems like ordinary wood on an ordinary patch of flagstone floor. You sit down. The Archmage relaxes a little and risks a small smile. There, better. Now I don't have to crane my neck to look at you. Reaching across his desk, he lifts the stopper on a decanter and pours out two glasses of thick red wine. He pushes one across the tabletop to you. So, where is it? You demand, unwilling to be swayed from your task. The crown of kings? He gestures at his head. I'm not wearing it, as you can see. Wait for him to continue. You wave a hand, waiting for him to continue. The Archmage nods. He seems to be chewing something over. You have caused me a lot of trouble, you know. I am old, as you see. I did not intend to grow old. That was your doing. The beacons of light, perhaps? Indeed. That was their purpose, he nods. The land was plentiful. It sustained me. But you destroyed my final tower here in High Zaman. Did you even realize what you had done? And how did you do it? That tower was built thousands of years before you were born. The tower itself moved through time. The Archmage frowns. No, such a thing is not possible. Not unless you yourself... He trails off. No matter. He fixes you with a long, thoughtful gaze. Do you know, Adelander, what it is the crown does? Do you understand its power? The crown controls the will of others. Precisely. But perhaps you have not quite understood the depth of that. The crown is a grimalkin. It is set with jewels of gold and lined with a ring of bone, and covers the wearer's skull in cloth. It generates spells of both illusion, worship, and mental insight. I know it cannot be left in your hands. Probably better off in his hands. I think I'm the evil one here. You talk of it like a weapon, the Archmage observes, but the crown does not grant victory. The crown causes the wearer's desires to become the unthinking thoughts, reflex actions, and spontaneous whims of those around. It occupies the free will itself. Free will? Of whatever you would call it, the inner voice. The part inside that is inspired, the part that dreams, the part that invents anew. That is the part the crown takes. Those under its command cannot know themselves to be controlled, and nor could anyone else. It cannot be resisted. The crown of kings shapes people the way the eons shape the course of a river. Why are you telling me this? His reply is strangely gentle. I am trying to make you understand something that will be most difficult to understand, and I mean you no offense by that. You are intelligent enough, but I fear you have a shock in store. He pauses for a moment. His eyes fill with a strange sadness. You have come a long way for this crown. I see that. You think me evil, a tyrant. But I am none of those things. I am the Archmage of the Fortress of Sorcerers, a fading but noble institution, and I spend my days trying to repair the terrible destruction wrought on the lands in my care by your ignorant, reckless use. Your ignorant, reckless use of the beacons of past light. You placed those beacons yourself. I did, and left untouched they would have protected the land for 10,000 years. Did you not notice the towers were all sealed? Past light burns with the power of the sun. It must be filtered, measured. But you opened 6 beacons wide and threw them over my land, over my people. He bangs the desk as he speaks, almost shouting. There's a tear in the corner of his eye. I am sorry for it. What good does that do? The land is wasted. The people are lost. His cracked voice quivers with rage. I really don't like any of these options that much. The fate of the world is at stake. Is it? Because I have this crown? Annalander, I do not have the crown, and I never did. Look him in the eyes. You stare at him. He gives every appearance of honesty. Then where is it? You demand. I am so sorry. I know how hard it will be to accept what has been done to you. But can you not, on some level, feel it? Do you not sense that you are not in control of yourself? Do I have the crown? Am I wearing the crown? What? Or is someone else wearing the crown and controlling my reality? What are you talking about? You have been under a spell for some time. I can imagine how it began. Most likely there was a day, in Annalan, perhaps near the wall, when you woke up and your will was not your own. And since then you have been compelled to march here, to do me harm. My will was not my own. So who's been controlling me? I do not understand. I think perhaps you do. Consider this. Do you even know what this crown looks like? This object that you have traveled so far, so single-mindedly to find, it might have been lying on a table in the first village you passed through, and you would not have known. Am I correct? It is the Crown of Kings. It is. But do you know what it looks like? And does it not seem strange you were not told? He shakes his head. My good woman, you have seen the crown already. You have stood in its presence, but you do not remember. Perhaps you think it was just a dream. Such is its power. But what else but the crown could have sent you on such a journey as this, at such terrible cost? I have dreamt of it, yes. Dreams, voices from deep inside, fighting for your attention. The Archmage's voice softens. Another question, then. You say you are called the Annalander, correct? You also call me the Annaland. Correct. He smiles. My friend, are you truly so far gone that you do not even know your own name? His words echo round the tiny room. Paper charts flutter. Your memories of Annaland, the king, and a childhood in Chorberry Wood all seem suddenly distant, like vague mentions, half-remembered overheard stories, mere snippets. If the crown is so powerful, how could my birdman have stolen it from your king? Continues the Archmage gently now. Think, Annalander. Think for yourself just once before you strike me down. Try to remember. You strain your mind, trying to remember. Waking in the hut in a northern settlement, sword ready, dreaming of the crown. Where were you before that moment? How did you come to be on this quest for which you have given so much? I do not know. That's where this journey started. Stand. You get to your feet, head reeling. The Archmage looks at you with compassion. It is upsetting to hear. I understand that. But if you are right, you begin weakly, then why am I here? A good question, the Archmage nods. I imagine your king sent you simply to kill me. Your king has a crown, and he knows that we in Manpang Fortress are the only ones capable of countering its power. The crown can be countered? All magic can be countered, but to counter the crown, one must cast a spell in the presence of the crown that its wearer does not want to cast. It is quite impossible. The Archmage sighs. I am sorry, Annalander, or whoever you truly are. Your whole quest has been a lie. The crown is in Annaland, and you are nothing but an assassin. What do I do now? The Archmage holds your gaze for a moment before replying. First, you should rest. We will find you a chamber here in the tower, away from the hustle and bustle below. Then, when you are somewhat recovered, you will discover what you want to do. Demand the crown. Enough of this. You step forward, intent on demanding the crown's return. Then you pause. Where did that demand for action come from? What power put the thought of demands into your mind? Surely the Archmage is right. What compelled you to cause so much harm on your journey? You do not move. I want to see what happens if we shout. Scream? The Archmage watches you. You stand quite still, breathing in and out. A clarity is entering your muddled mind. Perhaps you are beginning to overcome your orders, the elderly figure observes. That is good. One step at a time. I would have left the choice there, guys, but there was like too many. It was too many choices. I actually wanted to see if I could eliminate shout and just have those three, but now, You find you are speaking. Thank you, Archmage. I have been lost for a long time, and I am far from my home. He nods. I understand. We will offer what hospitality we can. It is most appreciated, you reply, bowing your head. The Archmage gestures to the door, and you take your leave. What? Outside, night has fallen. Several hours pass in a darkened room. You are lying on cold stone. Where am I? Well, we're downstairs a few flights from where we were. You You look down. You look about yourself. You're on the flagstones of a small cell. A grate high up allows in a little starlight. Look at the door. The heavy door has a single grill snap shut. The walls are marked with nearly 100 strokes. Have you made them yourself? How long have you been there? From nearby, you hear a scratching sound. Who's there? You demand. There is no reply from the shadows. The scratching gets closer. Move backwards. You scramble backwards. A tiny figure appears on spindly legs. You cannot believe your eyes. It is Jan, the mini-mite you encountered outside Baratanti. Yeah, that's part one. Jan. The creature stares at you, then rushes forward and wraps spindly arms around your leg. Aw. You again, it chirps. Do you have any idea how hard it's been to follow you? You followed me? I did my best. I didn't want you to know. I thought you might send me away, or worse. I guess it didn't follow me that closely because I've been using magic. Unless the magic has been part of the illusion all along and I have not been using it at all. But why? I thought you left. We mini-mites aren't entirely without magic, Jan replies. I stayed far enough away from you that you could cast yours. Except once. Oh, okay. Well, that answers my questions. Except once. When? You don't remember? Jan giggles. Well, I'll leave you to remember for yourself, maybe. But I'm sorry, you won't be able to cast anything now, and I can't escape. They clip my wings. Jan turns around and shows you the ruin of his back. Deep scars pucker the skin between between bony shoulder blades. I'm so sorry. That's horrible. Jan nods. Thanks, I suppose, for what good that does. He makes a mild chuckling noise. But now you're stuck as well. I suppose we're back together. So, what's your plan? How do we get out of this? You don't have a key, do you? No. Typical of you, Jan replies. Why am I going to draw my sword to attack him? Why did you follow me? You're after the Crown of Kings, aren't you? How are you expecting to get to it without a mini-mite's aid? Jan shrugs. I thought that was obvious. We've no love of Manpang. You look around the cell, regarding the walls, door, ceiling rafters with care. The place seems quite solidly built. The only opening is a tiny air grate, a little larger than your bald fist, set more than twice your height up in the wall. The little creature hops a little closer. If you really have no ideas, Jan remarks, then I suppose we best get comfortable. I know a few songs we could sing. Don't you dare. Jan shrugs. You better think of something, then. Look at the grate. The grate would be wide enough to toss a ball through. Beyond, you see nothing but the empty sky. Oh, sorry, open sky. Jan is watching you, and he nods almost imperceptibly. He goes over to a wall to scratch his back against it. From outside the window, the sounds of chanting and clanking metal drift upwards. The armies are assembling, the mini-mite murmurs. Now you've been found. They're leaving for the backlands. Where are they going after that? Where do you think? Jan replies. Annalan, Bryce, Willowstone, Lumley, everywhere. The Archmage intends to unite the entire old world. Okay. These are all negative things. This is a disaster. It would look like it. The Archmage had you dancing like a bear with a ring through its nose when you came in here. What? He sits down glumly. Were we tricked? Had me dancing like a bear with a ring through its nose? I thought it was real. I don't even know. Pick him up? You pick the mini-mite up in your hand. He fits neatly into your fist. What are you doing? The creature asks, voice shaking a little with fear. The stumps of his destroyed wings flicker and scrape against your palm. Can you not allow me some magic? You will die in here if you do not. The mini-mite shakes his head. I'm not eating your magic. I just muddy it. It's part of what I am. After a moment, he adds quietly, Believe me, I'm sorry too. pray for aid. You close your eyes to pray, but there is nothing. No god and no spirit can reach you here. You are quite alone. I don't know why I'm going to draw my sword. To attack the mini-mite? I don't want to do that. Cast a spell? It's not going to work. Let's try. Open locks and doors. You open your arms to cast a spell and feel the energy of the starlight pass through you, but nothing happens. The mini-mite looks... Oh, we wasted one stamina. Looks at you with tired eyes. I suppose it was worth trying, he sighs. Something passes over Jan's face. In the hills, he remarks. You saved my life, I think. Oh, I don't remember. That was a year ago. Did I? Jan nods. I didn't think you liked me, he continues. But you could have gotten rid of me, and you didn't. It was good to have a companion. I still didn't like being without my spells. No, Jan replies, smiling ruefully. It was nothing but trouble. Just as I am trouble now, the creature sighs. But what? There is a way out of this yet, the creature replies sadly. The effect of a mini-mite's blood is all about distance, and there's none in the walls here. It's only me. How high up would you say we were? The effect of a mini-mite's blood? What am I going to do, bleed it out? Why does that matter? The creature says nothing, but you notice it glance upwards toward the open grate in the wall. There must be another way. There must be some other way, you whisper to the tiny creature. I'd do it for you, Jan replies, but I can't fly. But if you throw me, I'll ball myself up. I won't do it, you reply. Then you starve to death in here, Jan replies. You can only shrug at that. The mini-mite slips to the floor once more. The situation is hopeless. You sink down against the wall. There's no quicker way to die. What follows is a slow, agonizing death, listening to the sounds of the army of Mampang as it recedes into the distance on its way to war. You are starved to death in a cell. So I'm guessing we're not rewinding. I was hoping we might be on death, like if we had died in battle. You feel the cold veil of death surrounding you, but a moment later you find yourself moving upwards. I've got spells. Huh. I've got spells. Whoop. Is this anything I can use? The Zed spell. Let me guess, that's the only spell that will work. Whoops. Hey. Us jerking around here. Alright, Zed. Unknown. You do not cast a spell, but rather it casts you, pulling you open, only to scatter you into the winds. You're kidding me. You are being wrenched in directions you did not know existed. The pain is unbearable, and just when you think you will go mad from it, the forces tear you apart. Then you hit the ground, in one piece, in a thin alleyway leading from the grate. It is where you met the beggar, but he is nowhere to be seen. I lost 1 point of maximum stamina. The Archmage's army is gone. The Sorcerer's Spike stands firm once more. You have another chance, but how can you overcome the Archmage? He knew you were coming. He was waiting for you. How can you possibly hope to defeat the terrible power of the Crown? There must be another way. To reach him. A quieter way. A way to steal inside the tower without the Archmage's knowledge. He is the greatest seer that has ever lived. You will need to shield yourself in a magic more powerful even than his, and find a way into his tower that he cannot guard against. You need to find an unseen way into the Sorcerer's Spike. I still don't know if I'm evil or what. Was what the Archmage said was true? I mean, I thought I realized it, that I was an assassin. And then I found out he made me dance like a bear, apparently. Check myself over. You pat yourself down. You are quite alive. What is more, you have all your possessions and gold and knowledge intact. The narrow alley mouth opens into a square. The stars turn in the sky overhead. Okay. So I found a way. You emerge from the alley into the edge of the main square. Let's see if we got clues here. Well, he's not dead. There's that. I have items. Oh! My sword is gone! Oh, man! Wait. Yeah, it's weapons. What am I gonna do with these fistful of gems? I guess nothing. Well, at least we still have the guard's uniform. If I had taken it off, I don't know if we'd have it now. Alright. So we have not been up here, and we have not seen the rest of these towers. Other than that... Oh, you know there's more towers over here as well. I'm saying head back for the towers. Just don't cast that spell. The buildings on the eastern edge are a little more ramshackle. The arch to the merchant's building leads away here. An alley runs past it. An empty pillory sits to the north of here. The cold night lingers on. Glancing down the alley, you see a distant touch of smoke. Some kind of fire? You could cross the square or explore the fringes. Let's go back to these towers. You enter an alley littered with refuse. Buildings either side are leaning or collapsed. In a dim half-light, you nearly trip over two men who are leaning against a wall. They straighten and turn to see you. Seems we have a visitor, one said. His eyes are closed, and so are his comrades. These are the deadly red eyes of Kari, whose very gaze can burn. Huh. Just passing through. No, you're stopping here, I think, the man replies. A moment later, you hear the crunch of footsteps. There is another now standing behind you. I'm going to leave it here. Not the most momentous decision that could have been made in this episode. But what do you think? These red eyes of Kari, whose very gaze can burn. I don't think it's a good idea to threaten them. So what do you guys think? Should I greet them, threaten them, or ignore them? Mind you, we're trying to get past them to get to these towers again, because we have not explored all of them. So, yeah, that's it for this episode, guys. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks for voting. Let me know if we should greet these people, threaten them, or ignore them. And, yeah, thanks again, and endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.